Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning. I hope you found the last 4 days to be informative and of interest, and I hope that you'll continue to find today to be equally informative and of interest. Before we commence today, I'd just like to say thank you very much to Ms. Sinha for inviting me to participate in your workshop. It's a pleasure to be here. I've been asked to discuss with you some of the challenges that are associated with food microbiological tests, and I've been specifically asked to focus on requirements for good laboratory practice. So that's what we're going to spend the next hour doing, hopefully. So perhaps before we start, it would be useful for me to get a feel for how many of the organisations that you work for undertake microbiological testing. Could you just have a general show of hands? Okay. And of your organisations, how many of you actively work in the microbiology laboratory? So you're going to find this session very interesting. And I apologise for the rest of you who are maybe more analytical focused. I hope you don't find it too boring, but hopefully you may be able to see that there are a lot of parallels that can be drawn in GLP between analytical chemistry and microbiology. Microbiology results are used by a large number of bodies to make some fairly important decisions on the safety and quality of food, and if a product or a material complies with legislation or any specifications that may be set by clients, and increasingly helps the international trade and movement of food materials. So it's important that microbiology laboratories within your own organisations can demonstrate to the users of your services that your results are reliable and that they can have confidence in those results and the actions that they then take based on those. So I guess the big challenge for food microbiology laboratories is to demonstrate their ability to deliver accurate, reliable results. And you could also add to that list timely and consistent and defendable. But the purposes of today's presentation, we're going to focus very much on accuracy and reliability. And to achieve this, microbiology labs do need to effectively manage and control their testing operations in accordance with recognised good laboratory practice. So what do we mean by good laboratory practice? I guess I could ask that question to each of you round this table. So I guess the big question is, what is meant by GLP? And as I said, if I asked each of you around this table, you would all give probably very similar answers, but also subtly different ones. And I think if you ask most people connected with microbiology what they think good laboratory practice means, they would say it relates to the adoption of good bench practices and techniques when carrying out the testing activities. And that's a very important part of what constitutes GLP. And we're going to cover quite a lot of that during this session. But it is important to recognise that GLP cannot and shouldn't be regarded as being one single constituent of a laboratory's activities, but rather being defined as being made up of a number of different components that can all impact on testing and thus the results that are issued. And I think this slide helps to illustrate this very well. I'm guessing most of your laboratories, if not all of your laboratories, hold some form of accreditation for testing through NABL. Yeah? So that will probably look very much like an interpretation of the contents of 17025. And you can see how it's all designed around analyses, because that's what we as laboratories do. We perform testing activities. So anything that can have an impact on the analysis can have an impact on the accuracy and the reliability of the results that we produce. For example, if the methods you're using, even if the methods you're using are recognised standard methods like the Bureau of Indian Standard Methods or ISO methods, if the people performing those tests haven't been properly trained and the techniques that they're using to carry out the test, then the results are not going to be reliable. Similarly, if the equipment that you're using cannot be demonstrated as operating within the parameters that the methods require, that can also have an impact on the result. So you need to take an holistic look at GLP and realise that it is comprised of multiple components. So what does GLP mean in relation to helping to ensure the reliability of test results? Well, first of all, let's think about what do we mean by reliable. Well, one definition could be that the result reflects the true level of the microorganism in the sample that you're testing, and that the result is not being influenced by any external contamination that could have resulted from the laboratory environment in which the test is done, through poor handling practices in the laboratory associated with the test. So these are some of the components of good laboratory practice that can have a very strong bearing on ensuring the reliability of microbiological results. And the biggest challenge that does face food microbiology laboratories is being able to show that the result that they're issuing is from the actual test portion of the sample, and not as a result of contamination from the environment within the lab, or poor handling practices, bad aseptic techniques, or tardiness in the time taken to analyse the sample after it's been received. And this session is going to very much focus on a number of those areas, because it is specifically related to GLP. Let's have a look at what components of GLP can influence the accuracy of results. But first, let's think about what do we mean by accurate. An accurate could be defined as the ability to get the right result first time. Now, during the course of this week, I know you've had presentations on a number of areas, so I'm going to try to not duplicate the information too much. But I think at this point, it is useful and very valid to say that the starting point of all analyses is your method. And it's essential that microbiology laboratories do use methods that are fit for purpose and are suitable for the sample matrix in question. Obviously, it's good practice to always use methods that are recognised as standard methods, or if you're using commercial proprietary methods, those that have been validated by recognised international third parties like the AOAC or AFNOR, or have been validated to internationally recognised standards for demonstrating the performance of commercial methods. And alternatively, you may be able to use industry recognised normal methods. I think it's important to reiterate, irrespective of the status of the method, that laboratories should undertake some work to demonstrate the method's performance in their hands with their people and their systems before introducing it into routine use. And additionally, it's important that laboratories also repeat this type of work if they make any changes or modifications to the methods that could have an impact on its performance. Appropriate measures should be taken when performing, making media and doing performance checks. The majority of microbiological methods need media to greater or lesser extents, and ensuring that the media is performing well is a very important component of GLP in ensuring the accuracy of results. Laboratory personnel need to be properly trained and have a good understanding of the methods that they're undertaking, and need to be shown as competent in the test. And it's important that when you're training people in microbiological methods, as with chemistry methods, that at the end of training, some form of practical test to generate objective technical data to show their competence is needed. And that data is something that you can store in their training records. It's important that through training, people adopt good bench practices and good aseptic techniques. And microbiological tests, particularly the traditional methods, can take several days from the start to finish. And it's important that the working practices within the laboratory are such that plates and broths and confirmatory work are read or subcultured on the due date at the right time. And that invariably means that laboratories do need to provide some form of weekend cover and public holiday cover if tests are due out at those times. And certainly back at home, it's very routine for microbiology labs to run 7 days a week. After the initial validation or evaluation of a method has been conducted, it's important that laboratories do have programs in place where they can regularly demonstrate the ongoing performance of the method in their hands and their ongoing competence in its conduct through regularly participating in external proficiency tests and through operating what we call an internal method performance and staff proficiency program. So all of these are probably sounding very similar to what the chemist needs to do in their laboratories. We're just twisting it for microbiology. So let's have a look at some aspects of GLP in relation to the reliability of results. In microbiology, we're dealing with living microorganisms that can grow and can die if we don't ensure that the environment in which they're handled is controlled. It's important within the laboratory that the size of the facility is adequate for the volume of work and the staff numbers. Facilities that are very cramped means separation of activities or work that could pose contamination risks to each other will be poor, and that does increase the risk of contamination. And I've seen this in a number of laboratories where they have had problems with environmental control because of the facility not being sufficient size for the volume of work. Airborne contamination is a real risk to microbiology from mould spores that may be in the environment. So it's good practice for windows to not be opened in micro labs and to ensure that the temperature and humidity is controlled so that it doesn't compromise the tests or the operation of any equipment, because most microbiological tests do require incubation at very specific temperatures and tolerances to ensure the reliability of the results. In microbiology, separation of activities, preferably by space, but also by time, is important to consider. And I'd encourage you, each of you, to go back to your laboratories and have a look at the internal design and layout of the laboratory in relation to what work is done where and when. And look at, have you any potential risks of cross-contamination? And by perhaps modifying the working practices, removing those. It's very common for wet activities like media preparation, wash-up, and certainly waste decontamination to be done in a separate room to the main laboratory area where samples are handled and prepared and tested. Sample receipt, it is good for that to be in an area away from where practical work is being done so that you don't inadvertently contaminate the sample with any organisms that you're culturing or that you're confirming. And ideally, within the laboratory, there should be a one-way process flow from the preparation stage through plating and subculture work and reading and confirmation. Microbiology labs do need to handle cultures, which can include pathogens, as part of media QC checks that they're required to perform on the media that they make, or as part of daily controls or confirmatory controls. And it's important that we have control over where those organisms are stored and how they're handled so that they don't pose a contamination risk to samples. In microbiology laboratories, it's good practice to operate a formal cleaning and disinfection program, which is formalised with defined frequencies and records to show that it's been done. And this is important to keep the facility appropriate for the type of tests and to make sure that any background flora levels are kept to a level that doesn't pose any adverse risk to work and results. So it's important that your cleaning covers the facility, like the benches, the floors, cupboards, windows, but also equipment like the interiors of incubators and fridges, water baths. Accidents can happen in any laboratory. If there are any culture spills or biohazardous spills, it is important that laboratories take prompt action to disinfect and treat those spills. And it's important that you look at the procedures your laboratory adopts in these areas, because you want to make sure that you do effectively decontaminate those type of spills so that you don't have a focus or a source of contamination in the laboratory. So it's important that you give some thought to the type of disinfectant and the concentration and make sure it's suitable for the nature of the spillage and the organisms that you're handling. Disinfectants do need time to exert their bactericidal effects, so you do have to make sure that there is an appropriate contact time with the spill for it to exert its effect. And it's always good practice, particularly if it's a major spill, to do some form of post-treatment verification to ensure that the treatment you've applied has successfully killed the culture. And this is typically done by either swabbing the relevant area or using some form of contact plate and screening for the absence of the target organism if it's a known culture spill, or perhaps doing a general total viable count to verify that the bioburden of that area has been dropped through the disinfectant process. Because the last thing you want is salmonella or listeria living in your laboratory environment. It is important, and it is good practice in microbiology labs, to verify the cleaning as being effective and to ensure that the hygienic practices followed by laboratory staff and working practices associated with conducting the tests and handling cultures don't introduce sources of contamination into the laboratory. And it's very common and indeed standard practice for this to be achieved by monitoring air quality in the laboratory and monitoring the hygienic levels of surfaces. It's common for air quality to be monitored via exposing suitable non-selective plates, agar plates, but in some cases using selective agar plates may also be beneficial, particularly if you handle or are looking for yeasts and moulds. It's good practice to do a mould exposure plate to verify and monitor the levels of mould spores in the environment. Samples are at greatest risk of contamination from the air when they're being opened and handled. So it's important that the data you generate from these air plates is as pertinent as possible to help you defend your results. So it's best practice to do air plates when you're actually handling samples, cutting them up, processing them for analysis. Monitoring the hygiene of surfaces can be achieved through contact plates or swabbing of those areas, and then screening for general bacterial counts. But it's also good practice for those laboratories that are looking for and handling infective pathogens like Salmonella, Listeria, Campylobacter, to also swab relevant areas of the laboratory to look specifically for the absence of these pathogens. How many of your laboratories do handle or screen for pathogens? Yeah, one or two. The type of areas that you cover do need to be given some thought to. It's always good to swab benches, but it's also good to also challenge staff contact areas such as door handles or door pushers, keyboards on computers that may be present in the lab, and taps handles and people's hands, because they can be very potent sources of contamination. But it's also important that we do look at the cleanliness of benches where we're actually doing the practical work. One or two key things to bear in mind. These surfaces will have residues of sanitizers because we clean in a lab, but we don't rinse afterwards. The whole point is to kill. So there will be residues of sanitizers and disinfectants on these surfaces. So the contact plate or the broth that you use to moisten the swab should contain appropriate neutralizers for the disinfectants and sanitizers that you use, so that you're not inhibiting the recovery of microorganisms. It's important that laboratories review results from environmental monitoring and look for trends. And as you build up data, you'll be able to set criteria to appraise the results. And it's important that you take action if you find any spikes in recovery occurring from the environment, or if indeed you get any out of specification results. If ever you isolate a pathogen from the laboratory, obviously immediate action has to be taken, because you have a very real risk that you could be cross-contaminating your samples and thus issuing false reports to your clients regarding the pathogen's presence. Obviously, the first thing would be to do is to take immediate action and disinfect and recheck the area. But it's also good practice to escalate screening of the laboratory environment. In other words, check more areas of the facility to verify, is this just an isolated case of isolating the pathogen, or is that pathogen much more widespread within the laboratory? And if it's the latter, you've got a big problem. It's always important to investigate where the source of the pathogen came from, what was its cause, because that way you can take the right corrective action to prevent reoccurrence of the pathogen in the environment in the laboratory. And as I said, it's important that you do appraise the impact of isolating a pathogen in the lab on any results or ongoing work. For example, have you issued any positive Salmonella samples in the weeks leading up to that isolation? Could that have been as a result of contamination in the lab rather than genuinely having Salmonella present in the lab? And this is just a little hint and tip. Certainly at home, it's very common and indeed standard practice for laboratories to use as their control culture for Salmonella a serotype that's not frequently associated with food poisoning at home. And the labs will hold the anti-sera to that specific culture so that they can determine whether any contamination in the lab is their own control culture. And also, if they identify Salmonella from any samples, they can check that it's not their control strain, which gives them confidence in reporting a true positive result. So that's just something to bear in mind and perhaps feedback to your laboratories. In microbiology, hygiene practices are essential. Obviously, the general laboratory hygiene rules of no eating, drinking, smoking apply, and keeping long hair tied back. possibly consider using wearing beard snuds and keeping jewellery on hands to a minimal and nails short. Hand washing should be adhered to on entry and exit of the laboratory, and the soap that should be used should be bactericidal. And it's also good practice to wash hands regularly in between activities and after handling pathogens or reference cultures. Microbiology coats should ideally be visually distinct from other laboratory clothing that may be worn, such as coats worn in the chemistry laboratories. Microbiology coats should not be worn outside micro labs for safety reasons, and they should be long-sleeved because part of the premises of a coat is to protect you from the work, but also to protect the work from us, because we naturally have microorganisms on our skin. It's important that they're long-sleeved and that they're worn correctly, and ideally have cuffs that are tight rather than loose, so that when you are doing practical work, you don't have the potential for cuffs falling into the work and becoming contaminated. The coats do need to be regularly changed and laundered. Do your organisations use external laundries, or do you wash them yourselves in-house?
External.
Think about how they are packaged and sent out to the laundry. And if you think your laboratory coats could be contaminated, then it is good practice to decontaminate the coats before they go to an off-site laundry, or indeed an on-site one, maybe through chemical disinfection or autoclaving. It is good practice to consider adopting a coat change policy between different areas of the laboratory, for example, between the main laboratory and the pathogen room, or implementing a coat change if you're doing different activities, maybe if you're preparing heavily contaminated materials or raw materials compared to processed foods where the microbiological level may be lower. If you don't operate a coat change procedure, then it would be useful for your organisation to review this or document a formal risk assessment to support the absence of coat changing and the controls that you've got in place to show that that's not a risk. The wearing of sterile gloves is important and is indeed needed for a number of activities within microbiology. But gloves can sometimes lead to a false sense of security in terms of hygiene. And it is important that those gloves are regularly changed or regularly disinfected with maybe alcohol gel to prevent them from becoming a source of contamination to work. Okay, moving on to think about good laboratory practice associated with handling of samples. Microorganisms, as I said, are living entities, and their levels can be affected by temperature and time. So it's important that laboratories have good practices in place for the transportation of samples. This isn't always in the control of the laboratory. Sometimes the clients are responsible for delivering the samples to the lab. How many of you provide a delivery service for samples? One or two of you? But I guess the majority, it's the client's responsibility to get the samples to your laboratory. In this case, in microbiology, it might be useful to discuss with your client the best ways of transporting samples for microbiological analyses to the lab to ensure that they are in a fit state for analysis. It's important that samples are transported in a timely manner and that the packaging of them protects them from damage or contamination. It's important that the transportation conditions minimise abuse or changes in the sample condition that could influence changes in the microbiological status of the product. This is particularly important if you're testing frozen or refrigerated chilled samples, or very susceptible samples like water and environmental swabs. And these should be transported under refrigerated conditions in ice boxes with ice packs or cool box blocks. If you're testing vulnerable samples and the time for transportation from the client to your laboratory is considerable and you have concerns over temperature control, then it would be useful to consider monitoring temperature during transportation. You can get data loggers that you can pop into PACS these days and download the temperatures on receipt, or get the client to include an extra, we call it a sacrificial sample, that you can probe and take the temperature of on receipt to verify that the temperature of the sample has been abused. If any of these monitorings or checks show significant temperature abuse, it may not be appropriate for your laboratory to test that sample. And this is where you need, it's good practice to talk to your clients about the situation. And if a decision is subsequently made to test those samples, then it's good practice to record the temperature of the samples on receipt in the certificate of analysis so that the results can be interpreted accordingly. Because if temperature abuse has occurred and you're reporting high levels of microorganisms, that might be as a result of the abuse the sample experienced during transportation rather than the true levels that were present in the sample. Sample receipt should be away from other work or activities within the microbiology lab, or indeed it can be outside of the microbiology lab. If your laboratories handle food matrices of different bioburdens, it is worth considering dedicated benches for high-risk dirty samples and a separate bench for the cleaner ones. If that's not possible, consider the order in which you register samples when they arrive, or disinfect the work surfaces in between different batches of samples so that you're not introducing the potential for contamination or cross-contamination. It's important that samples are promptly registered into the laboratory system and that you check that the condition of the sample is suitable for testing. Look for any evidence of abuse of the sample. Look for any leakages or splits or damage to the packaging which could have allowed microorganisms to ingress into the product. And if you have any question over the potential suitability of a sample for analysis, again, it's good practice to liaise with the client to discuss that and make a decision on whether the analysis should or shouldn't proceed. And again, if a decision is made to test the sample, it is important that the condition or the anomaly or the damage is included alongside the sample description in the final certificate of analysis. So again, the end user can interpret the reports with that in mind. If they don't know there was abuse or the report doesn't indicate there is an abuse, they could be interpreting the results incorrectly. When samples are stored in the laboratory after receipt, it's important that we ensure that how we handle the samples does not influence the microbiological status of that sample. So it's important that we have dedicated areas for the storage of ambient stable products under dry conditions, for refrigerated samples and frozen samples. Freezing is a sublethal injury step. In other words, it can kill some bacteria, but it's not a fully lethal step. So it's not good practice to store ambient, stable, or chilled samples frozen before testing, because you could be lowering the true microbiological status of the sample as a result of freezing. When you're storing samples, it's important to give some thought to segregation according to the nature of the sample, their microbial loading. And it's good practice to have dedicated sample refrigerators. But in some laboratories, particularly very small laboratories, they may not be able to do that. And you may have one fridge that might be used to store multiple materials. So it's important that you do give some thought to segregation of those, so that there is minimal risk of the samples posing a risk to sterile media that might be in the fridge, and raw materials being separated from cooked. It's good practice to retain the unused portion of a food after testing until the results are off. And that's important because if errors occur during the analysis, you have the original sample to go back and retest. And it also enables you to do further investigations if you or your client require. In microbiology, timeliness of testing samples, particularly perishable samples, is important because you can have microbial die-off or growth. Ideally, perishable samples like chilled food materials, unless you're testing products at end of shelf life, should be tested on the day they are received at the laboratory, or in exceptional circumstances, if they arrive particularly late in the evening, should be tested within 24 hours of being received. Again, this is to ensure that the result you're getting is a true reflection of the microbiological condition of the sample and not for any changes that have been associated due to the aging of the sample. If you test water or environmental swabs or hygiene swabs, these are very unstable materials, and ideally they should be tested within 4 hours of them being taken or lifted at the source, but should really be tested, if that's not possible, within 24 hours. Many laboratories that have both microbiology and chemistry operations can sometimes be asked to perform both types of analyses on the same sample. And in those cases, it's best practice to encourage your client to send separate samples, one for chemistry and one for microbiology. But sometimes that, whilst we might ask that, it might be difficult to achieve that. So if that's not possible, then microbiology should receive the sample first for testing, because obviously they want to make sure that it's not been contaminated through non-aseptic handling practices that would happen in chemistry. Or it might be appropriate, if it doesn't compromise either the microbiology or the chemistry test, to subsample the samples to create separate samples for both laboratories. Moving on to the actual analysis of the samples, all testing has to start with preparing the sample for analysis. And again, this is where we need to make sure that we aren't contaminating the test portion that we take through the test. If you're testing raw or highly contaminated materials, it could be beneficial to consider a separate sample preparation room for those type of samples, or separate bench areas with dedicated equipment. But again, that's the ideal. That's not always possible or feasible in many laboratories. So if you can't separate these materials, then it would be better practice to analyse these after all of the samples have been prepared. But again, that may not fit into the working practices of the laboratory or the timeline with which the various samples arrive at the laboratory, in which case you would need to consider a full clean down of equipment and surfaces in between samples of different microbial loadings. But one thing that is important is that clinical samples, such as blood, faeces, sputum, soil and effluent, shouldn't be tested in the same room where food samples are handled and analysed. So I don't know if any of your laboratories also do clinical work, but if that is the case, then it is better to separate those activities into different laboratories. One important component of good laboratory practice relating to the reliability of results is the adoption of good aseptic techniques by us when we're physically carrying out the tests. This initially extends to the working area in which we're doing the test, so that the area should be cleaned and disinfected to remove or reduce sources of contamination. It's important that there's no drafts and people movement is kept to a minimum. It is important that microbiologists have everything that they require for the work ready before processing samples, so that make sure the media is ready and it's cooled, that the pre-poured plates you need to use are dry, and that all your plates are labelled. And the reason for this is because as soon as you add the diluent or a broth to your test portion, it's good practice to complete the inoculation of media within 45 minutes. So get everything ready before you start to prepare samples. And it's very common for laboratories to use a teamwork approach, have person A cutting and weighing samples and stomaching them, and person B perhaps diluting and inoculating media, and person C pouring plates. But if laboratory analysts are working in isolation, then it's good practice for them to only prepare and process samples in small batch numbers so that they can complete all stages of that, of the preparation, in 45 minutes. Avoid talking, coughing, sneezing over work so that we're not imposing a contamination risk. And one thing that's important to look at is the risk of aerosol production in the laboratory. Aerosols are a major cause of environmental contamination. And there are some sources which are obvious and some that are not so obvious. One obvious source is people emptying pipettes too vigorously so that splash ripping occurs. If you use nichrome wire loops to streak and subculture, flaming wet loops can create spitting, which can release aerosols, which could contain bacteria. If you're opening ampules of freeze-dried materials to prepare your own cultures, those can be sources of contamination. Something like mixing cereal dilutions using shakers and centrifuges, and sloppy practice and technique associated with discarding pipettes and disposing of liquids. So it's good practice to have a look at the working techniques in the laboratory to see, do you have a risk of aerosol production? And if you do, to try and look at modifying your techniques to reduce those risks. When handling samples, if you're testing dehydrated powder samples, these can be notorious materials that could contaminate the environment or other work or samples. So if you're handling dehydrated powders, if you can, it might be useful to consider a separate room or a different area within the laboratory, or to handle those in a protective hood. And if you're testing products that are likely to contain pathogenic bacteria, if your national legislation over here requires, you may need to do that work in a safety cabinet. It's good practice to swab the area of the packaging that you're going to cut to remove the test portion with alcohol or an equivalent disinfectant. And the implements that we use to open the packs and to then cut up and remove the portion of the food that we want to test need to be sterile. And they need to be cool as well. There are a number of ways in which implements can be sterilised, but the important thing is to handle them so that they prevent contamination while they're being used. After use, it's important that implements are placed into a suitable container for disposal or cleaning and reusing so that they don't pose contamination risks. A lot of laboratories will use two-piece scalpels where you have the blade and the handle. Make sure the blade area, the attachment between the blade and the handle, is properly cleaned, because that can be a really potent source of buildup of product debris. So really make sure those are cleaned. If you use forceps that are rough nose, in other words, have got the striations at the end, make sure any food debris is removed from the teeth of those noses. A lot of microbiological tests require pipetting of very precise volumes of inoculum into plates or into broths. So in addition to ensuring that people are pipetting accurately and that the volume being dispensed by your pipettes has been checked through some form of gravimetric weight check, it's important that good pipetting techniques are used to prevent the introduction of contamination risks. So some things are very obvious. Don't allow the pipette tip to touch the outside of the canister or the container from which it's been removed. Don't let it touch the outsides of stomacher bags or the lips or necks of tubes or the outer surfaces of plates and tubes. Don't handle the area of the pipette that's going to come into contact with the sample or the test material. And when you're dispensing the contents of pipettes, it's best practice to do it, have the pipette vertical and not at an angle, so that the contents run down the inside of tubes. And that can be really important when you're transferring very small volumes, for example, associated with salmonella subcultures, particularly if you're not then going to vortex the liquid to bring everything into the enrichment broth. Automatic pipettes are great devices. They significantly speed up the efficiency of testing samples, but they need to be used with caution because they can be very good sources of contamination as a result of people letting the plunger up too quickly and forgetting splashback onto the barrel of the pipette. Also, if those pipettes are going inside stomacher bags, make sure they don't come into contact with the inside of the bags and the product debris that's in there, because that could then pose a contamination risk to other samples being tested at the same time. There is a plethora of guidance for what diluents and how to prepare various samples. There is the ISO series of standards 6887 that give extremely good guidance on the type of sample weights, the type of diluents, and how to prepare particular samples for analysis to take into consideration different food components. But in all cases, it's important that when you take the test portion, that it's a representative sample that's taken. So if you have a multi-component sample, you should ensure that you take a component of each matrix in there. So if it's a pizza, you might want to take some of the base and different components of all the toppings. The correct weight needs to be taken, and it's important that when testing solid samples or particulate samples that they're homogenized in a stomacher or a blender so that the microorganisms are released into suspension so that they're available for you to take through to the next stage of the test. Quite often we need to do serial dilutions or decimal dilutions to reduce the number of bacteria present into levels that we can actually count successfully on plates. So it's important that those dilutions to series are done correctly, that the dilutions are mixed, and that importantly pipettes are changed in between each dilution. It's good practice to set up two plates, duplicate plates, for each dilution that is tested. And if you're expecting a count of the target organism from the sample, to set up two or more consecutive dilutions in the range where you're expecting to achieve a countable number of colonies on the plate. One of the challenges with food microbiology is that microorganisms are not evenly distributed in food. That's really important to remember, because the result you're getting is only a reflection of the microbiological condition of the test portion that you took. We have to then assume that that would be representative of the sample as a whole, but it's important to bear that in mind. And that's why it's important that when we take the test portion, that we try and ensure we get a representative sample of in that portion. And this is one of another challenges of microbiology. I digress a little bit. You can test two different portions of the same sample, and you can get potentially two different results. Two different laboratories can test two samples that have been taken from the same batch, but they can get different results. And that's one of the challenges of interpreting results, which I think you've either had or will have a session on. But it's important to remember that the results you're reporting are representative of the microbiological condition of the portion that you took through for testing. Most traditional microbiological methods require pouring or mixing of inoculum with agar. It's important that plates are poured quickly after the inoculum has been added, and this is to avoid colony aggregation. You often see like a blob of growth right at the bottom of a plate, and that can be attributed to the fact that the inoculum sat in the plate too long before being poured. Make sure that you lift the lid just high enough to get the pipette in to add the inoculum without it touching the sides of the plate. Dry agar bottles on removal from water baths before pouring them to make sure water droplets don't fall into plates. Make sure you're adding the required volume of agar stipulated by the method, and if it requires an overlay of the agar, that it is completely applied to the whole plate. Mixing of plates is important. It's important that it's done sufficiently well so that you evenly distribute the inoculum throughout the whole plate, which in turn then should mean that you get well separated colonies over the whole plate, which makes counting a lot easier. But it's important that it's not done too vigorously. You don't want plates to be swirled so much that agar sloshes into the underside of the lids. That's bad practice, and if any bacteria are taken up with that agar into the lid, they won't develop and form colonies, which means that you could be getting under recovery of the true levels. Spread plates also need to be done well. Think about the depth of agar in the plate so that it doesn't dry out during incubation, and make sure the level of agar is, the surface of the agar is level and free from bubbles. It's good practice to dry plates to remove some of the moisture from the surface and from the insides of lids. And this is particularly important if you think you may have spreading growth present or the organism you're looking for has the potential to spread. The common ways of doing this would be drying in a laminar flow cabinet or some form of drying oven with the lid removed and the agar placed side down. Like pour plating, spread the inoculum quickly after it's been applied to the plate and make sure your spreader is sterile and cool. One important thing is to avoid spreading the inoculum right to the edge of plates. Try and leave a gap around the edge of the plates, because you can get rings of growth around plates, which does make colony counting and interpretation extremely difficult. And another thing, which sounds like stating the obvious, but I do see this from time to time, allow the inoculum to absorb into the agar before you invert the plate for incubation. If you incubate plates whilst they're still wet, you run the risk of some of the inoculum falling into the lid, and therefore it's not going to be available through the test, and you will affect the accuracy of the result. A lot of enrichment techniques used for pathogens require streak plates to be prepared, and it's important that the techniques that you use do generate well-isolated, separated colonies on the plate. It's important that the right loop size is used. If you're transferring 10 microliters or 5 microliters, use the right loops, and that they are sterile. From a practical sort of management point of view, it's really important that microbiology labs know what work is ongoing, because some of our tests can take 2, 3, 4, 5 days to complete, and we may have to do work on different days for different stages of the test. So it's important that the laboratory management are able to identify what work is ongoing and at what stage. And vitally important is monitoring incubation times. Microbiological tests do have specific time periods, 24 hours plus or minus 2, 18 hours plus or minus 2, 72 hours plus or minus 4. So it's important that plates and broths and confirmatory work are incubated for the right times, and we need to be able to easily track that so that plates and materials don't get incubated for too short a period or conversely for too long. So a very common way is to label the shelves or the plates or the racks with bottles with the date and time in or the date and time that they're due out. Some laboratories have more comprehensive paper records tracking dates and times in and out and actually when they were taken out. And that's important to be able to verify that you have followed the method correctly. Critical to the accuracy of reports is the correct interpretation of growth on plates or reactions in broths. And this ISO standard 7218 is a really good document. And it gives really detailed advice on the optimum range of colonies to count and how to calculate results based on duplicate plates or weighted means, taking into account dilution factors. But one thing that's important at this stage is if you've made serial dilutions and growth has occurred, you should be looking for approximate tenfold reduction in counts between the different dilutions. And if you're setting up two plates at one dilution, you should be expecting to see similar levels of counts on both plates. If you don't have either of those two, then that indicates there's been some sort of problem either with the pipetting or the creation of the dilution series, and you need to look into that a little bit more carefully to determine whether you can identify which plate or dilutions are the right results. If that's not possible to do so, then you may have to think about voiding those results and repeating the analysis. One thing that your laboratories may not be doing, and it may be good practice to consider doing, is to retain positive plates and purity plates whilst confirmatory tests on the isolates are being done. This can be through putting them into sealed bags and keeping them chilled. And this can be very useful because if problems occur with confirmatory results or you get an inconclusive result, you have got the original plates and the purity plates that are made from those to do further work before you release a result. Media is an essential part of all microbiological tests, and having confidence in the performance of the media is really important. In addition to having control over your powders and supplements and prepared media, it's important that they are prepared and sterilised in accordance with manufacturer's instructions, and that after preparation you have defined shelf lives and storage conditions for the media which don't affect their performance. It's also important that quality control checks are done on media. Verify that the media is sterile. In other words, the growth you're getting off the plate is from the sample and not because the media was contaminated. And also some checks to verify the pH and the ability of the organism to support growth. Again, we normally do a two-day course for this, but there is an extremely good ISO standard that gives a great deal of guidance on all aspects associated with media preparation, storage, and quality control checks. And if your laboratories haven't got this, I would encourage you to get it. There is an update to this standard pending, so just bear that in mind. But storage and handling of media is important. Once agar is in a plate form, it doesn't last forever. It can dry, it can shrink. So you do need to control the timing with which you store these plates. It's preferable to store them before being dried. And if you want to keep them for prolonged periods of time, it's good practice to store them in sealed bags. Bottled media without supplement addition is more stable, and providing they're stored in sealed tubes or bottles under refrigerated conditions, you may be able to keep them for 3 to 6 months. And this can be really helpful to laboratories, because instead of making the media fresh every day, a lot of laboratories will prepare stocks of media, which enhances the working efficiency of the laboratory and increases the volume of work that it can process. If you're storing bottled agars, then they have to be melted before they're used. It's good practice to only melt a bottle of media once. So it's sterilised, it sets, and you melt it once. If there's any left over after that melt, you discard. Because one of the biggest problems associated with media failure is overexposure to heat or prolonged exposure to heat. Melting should be done in a boiling bath or free steaming in an autoclave. It's not good practice to re-sterilise media to melt it, because that's exposing it to excessive levels of heat, which could affect performance. Before it's used, it's important that it's cooled, and molten agar should not be held in a molten state for prolonged periods of time. Generally 4 hours is recommended as being the maximum time period for holding agar. For some media that is more heat labile, you may only want to hold it for less than that time. So it's important that you monitor the cooling time and the maximum hold time. And that's commonly done by writing times on the bottle tops or on a piece of paper next to the water bath. Because of holding times being approximately 4 hours, depending upon how your laboratories work, it's not uncommon for laboratories to have a morning shift of media and an afternoon shift of media. So sometimes meltdowns occur over lunchtime so that the media is ready for the afternoon working practices. And that's important to remember if your laboratory works extended days. Media performance, in other words, the QC checks that we do on media. This takes time. This is probably one of the more time-consuming quality control checks a laboratory will do, and you have to do it on every laboratory-prepared batch of media. Not only should you check the visual appearance of the media, but it's important you check that the pH is within the pH range specified in the method, because that can form part of the selectivity of the test. Make sure it's sterile. If you dispense critical volumes like the 90 mils of diluent or 9 mils of diluent into those volumes before sterilising, you can get evaporation loss during autoclaving. So it's important that you do check post-sterilisation that the volumes are within a tolerance that you've allowed. And a lot of laboratories find they sometimes have to add a little more to the tubes before autoclaving to compensate for evaporation loss. And the growth checks should include productivity, in other words, the level with which the media can recover the target organism that it's designed to isolate. But it's also important that the selectivity of selective media is also verified to check what level of inhibition of non-target organisms the media can occur. And these can be done by qualitative, quantitative, and semi-quantitative checks. And these are very comprehensively described in this document, so it's good bedtime reading. This document also will give you guidance on the type of cultures that should be used for productivity and selectivity checks, and also guidance on what would be considered a good productivity ratio and a good selectivity ratio. Just a couple of things to finish off. GLP, traceability of work. It's important in microbiology labs, as it is in chemistry labs, to be able to defend our results and show that our final result has been correctly calculated. So it's important that we do give some thought to the content of our technical records. In microbiology, we have to show that we have done the test in accordance with the method, which means we have to show that we did the right activities on the right days at the right times. So things like dates, that a sample was set up, data subculture was made, data plate was read, data confirmatory test was prepared, data confirmation test result was read, can be recorded. Record the identity of the person doing those activities, because you can then show through their training records that they were trained and competent in that test. If you record the batch codes of media or any commercial kits that were used, you can then go back to the media preparation records and the quality control records to show that the media was performing properly. But it's also important to record the raw data, as we call it, associated with the tests. What dilutions were set up, what the colony counts were from all the plates, so that you can show you did get decimal reductions, and if you set duplicate plates up, that you were getting good agreement in those two results. Recording biochemical reactions. If tests required confirmation, it's good practice to record the number of colonies taken for confirmation and what the individual confirmation results were. And if you run any controls through the method at the same time, record those results, because they all help to show the reliability of your results. What you don't want is to say, this is the sample we received, and this is my final result. You have to have all this information in between, because that can show you that you've calculated the result correctly. And if a client queries your results, you can demonstrate and defend your results. Conversely, it can also show that you've made a calculational error, but at least you can put your hands up and correct that. It's important that final results are correctly reported and calculated. And again, ISO 7218 does give extremely good guidance on how to take into account the dilution factor, the inoculation volume, the fact that you may have to adjust a count if only a proportion of the colonies confirm positive. It also gives you guidance on how to calculate weighted means if you've taken results from two dilutions. And it's also important that you correctly report results when no colonies were recovered. So for most products that require dilution, that would be less than 1 times the dilution factor with any adjustments for the inoculation volume. And sometimes products can be dirtier than we expect, and we actually may end up with all our plates being uncountable. In other words, they've got more than the maximum number of colonies we can reliably count. And we call that too numerous to count, or TNTC. And again, how do you report those? You can't just report a final result to a client that says there was too numerous to count per gram, because that's meaningless to the client. So you need to say that it was greater than the maximum number of colonies that the method defines can be counted, multiplied by the dilution factor with accommodation of any inoculation volume adjustment if it wasn't 1 mil. And detections need to be clearly reported as detected or not detected in the weight of sample that was taken through. Just a couple of things to finish off with very quickly. Assuring the quality of results. I think you've had a session already this week on proficiency testing, inter-laboratory comparisons. Yeah. That equally applies to microbiology as it does chemistry, and a lot of the information you've already been given for chemistry would equally apply to micro. This is some of the more important data a laboratory will generate, because it shows the ongoing performance of the method in your hands with your people and their competence in the test. We've already talked about media QC, but it's important that you perform these activities in accordance with defined plans. What do you participate in, and how often? And how are you going to do it? For internal purposes, you do need to use technically valid approaches. It's important your laboratory clearly defines the criteria by which it's going to appraise results. What's a good result? What's an okay result? What's a poor result? It's important that the laboratory regularly reviews these results and performances, and a lot of laboratories trend their Z-scores, trend the log difference in counts, because that's really important, because it enables you to react, identify and react to any poor results, or if you've got any trends. If any of these proficiency tests or internal method efficacy controls consistently show poor performances, what's that saying about the reliability of the results from that test that you're issuing to your clients? If you consistently perform poorly in a particular test, then you do need to have to question the reliability of the results that you're reporting to your clients. How many of your laboratories participate in microbiology proficiency programs? I appreciate you may not always do that. Yeah. Are these external international schemes? Pardon? FIPAS. Oh, FIPAS for microbiology, yeah. There are a whole LGC, QM, yes. Those are probably two of the biggest providers, and they are very good proficiency schemes for microbiology. They cover a very broad range of organisms, so you should be able to cover all the common spoilage, indicator, and pathogen organisms. These are really good because they're independent and they compare your laboratory's performance against your peers in other labs, and you're really looking for consistently good results. Sometimes you may get a marginally acceptable result, but what you don't want is poor results. If you get marginally acceptable results, it's important that you respond to those. It's saying they could be right, but they could also be a little bit inaccurate. And a lot of laboratories will actually take the approach of saying, we'll check our performance in the next scheduled proficiency round in the next couple of months, and we expect it to be good. But if it's still marginally acceptable, we might start to look at what are we doing that means our results are not as accurate as they could be. But obviously, if you get any poor results, you need to take immediate action to investigate, correct, and verify why. What you want to look for are bias and trends. I've been into a lot of laboratories where their Z scores are consistently good, but every single result they get from every single person is negative, which means there is a bias to under-recovering compared to other laboratories. So what are they doing that means they get less out of the sample than other labs? And that's where you look to improve your performance. It's important in micro labs, and we will finish up on this, that regular analysis of spike samples is undertaken, because these external proficiency samples are artificial samples. They're not reflective of those that your laboratory would normally test. So it's important that you have a program whereby you regularly take samples that are reflective of those that you would analyse and artificially contaminate them with known numbers of bacteria. And these numbers should be varied, and also for detection levels should include very low levels, like less than 10 salmonella per 25 grams, to challenge the ongoing limit of detection of the method. This can be a bit of a challenge, and a working party through an industrial working party through Campden did produce a guideline that gives guidance on how to demonstrate a method's suitability for use, and that includes how to spike samples with known numbers of bacteria. But it's important that you define your criteria for appraising results, trend your results, and if you have any poor results, to immediately investigate and take action. Now, those you might not do every day, every week, every month, so it's important that you have some form of more regular controls in place, and a lot of laboratories will run sterility checks through a method every day, and they'll run a positive control through the test every day, and sometimes a negative. If you're doing that, it's important to think about setting up those controls after the analysis of the samples, so that again you're not introducing contamination risk to the work. And if you use commercial biochemical galleries or anti-sera, it's important that you verify the performance of those kits or those materials and reagents. And commonly, laboratories will either put a positive and a negative control through each time they use those materials, particularly if they're not used very often, because it also gives the laboratory staff a reference point to identify and compare results and what's positive, or once per manufacturer's batch code or delivery. And all these enhance and strengthen the defendability of your results, reliability. So really, just to conclude, I hope you can see through rather a whistle-stop tour of microbiology GLP, that whilst bench practices associated with the conduct of tests are really important, it's also important that we do have control over other areas of our activity so that they don't have an impact, an adverse impact on the analysis, which in turn can affect the reliability of the results that we report. So thank you very much for your attention, and I apologise that for most of you it's not available. I'm conscious of the time and tea break. And Well, I'll put my glasses on so I can see you.
Yes.
Oh, that's better.
In your country, for taking up a legal sample, legal sample, what is the procedure you are going to do?
Samples that are lifted for enforcement purposes, certainly in the UK, are taken by our environmental health officers. I believe that when they lift that sample, they are also obliged to lift a duplicate to give to the food business operator so that they have a sample from the same time, so that if they want to have it tested, they can. There are procedures in place for packaging those samples, and they are put in tamper-proof containers, so that when they arrive at the laboratory as part of the sample receipt procedure, they can check that the sample hasn't been tampered with during transportation. If it's an enforcement sample, it does come with certain documentation, and that's important to know, because under EC Regulation 2073, any samples that are lifted by enforcement bodies have to be tested in accordance with the methods required in 2073. And that's important for a laboratory to know, because in microbiology, as in chemistry, there can be many different methods for an individual organism. And 2073 states that the ISO method should be used, or a proprietary method that's been validated against 16140. And if another method has to be used, then the local competent authority has to have approved the method for the laboratory. But, sorry, does that answer the question?
My question is sample, one who going to take the sample, that is for in our regulations, the food safety officers are going to take the legal sample. Then in your case, my intention is, while doing the analysis, only we consider the sample come over here. But one who is going to take the sample, it is to be a very important step in case of the microbiology.
Absolutely.
The analyst who are going to take the samples in presence of the artist in the sample case.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Lifting the sample at source is equally important. I was focusing more from the laboratory's point of view, but you're absolutely right. Aseptic technique has to be adhered to when a sample is lifted at source. If it's already in a finished product box, that's easy, but if you're taking it from a production line or you're taking some water from a tap, then obviously the sampling techniques have to be aseptic. The materials, equipment used have to be sterile. The products need to be accurately, and they have to be sealed, and the products have to be accurately labelled so that there's no confusion over to what sample it is. Yes, equally important, lifting at source.
Excuse me, sir. In case of fat samples in our country, we always receive only sealed original container samples for microbiology.
Yes.
Or do you receive any sample which you don't get
in
the original container or
sealed pack? Okay. For example, sweet sample. They're in bakery. They are going to take the sample, means it should be in aseptic condition.
Okay. No, talking about the
enforcement
samples.
Enforcement sample itself. But I'm telling only for the sample. Whatever it may be, for milk. They are sending in the market, it is not in the packaging condition.
We are processing in our lab for microbiology testing. All the samples we receive under act is sealed and it is received in original container. Otherwise, we don't consider for microbiology analysis.
It is a separate item. Now, I am asking about the sample, whatever it may be, the food sample. The seed sample I am asking. Madam, another question. Action taken for out of specification in your country, how many days it will take? Out of specification, not non-conformity samples.
Do you mean after the finished result's been issued and it's out of specification? That is really down to the person to whom the results are issued. Laboratories in the UK generally operate in one of two ways in relation to reporting results. If a client has not given them specifications, then they will report the results as found. But if a client has provided them with specifications, then the laboratory has to have agreed procedures by how those are informed. And that can include notifying clients that there's a presumptive positive. So if you've got a presumptive positive salmonella or listeria, the clients are normally informed, so they're aware, so that they can start to think about possible action in terms of product withdrawal or notifying clients. But they will obviously wait till the confirmed result. And that's really important that laboratories get confirmed results issued quickly. There isn't any legal requirement for the timeline between reporting results after the conclusion of analyses, but most laboratories will turn them around within about a day, so the recipient will have them fairly quickly. But in terms of how long the body to whom the results are issued takes to take action on those, I don't believe there's anything set, but obviously they would want, if it was an enforcement sample and salmonella was isolated, they would react immediately.
The final question. It is a general question. How many days we can store a raw meat samples? Regulation, is there any regulation to store a raw meat?
Is this before testing?
Before testing one. Before testing, not for the testing purpose, but in hotels they are putting in a frozen condition or any other.
I will openly say that's a little bit outside my area of expertise, because that's not really laboratory related, that's a commercial decision. But there will be industrial guidelines, and a lot depends upon the nature of the sample, the storage conditions. Freezing obviously would put any material into a microbial sort of static situation, but obviously you can get deterioration in quality with prolonged frozen storage. You get freezer burn and things like that. So I can't answer your question, I'm sorry, because it's not something that's my area of expertise.
What are the
Lab? Right, laboratories, from my experience, use a range of disinfectants. There isn't, as far as I'm aware, a mandatory requirement for a particular disinfectant. There are a lot of commercial disinfectants out there. 70% alcohol can be used, but a lot of laboratories will sometimes rotate the disinfectant they use to avoid build-up of resistance. Vircon is one that's widely used. Chlorine-based disinfectants rather are common. I think the key thing is to look at the manufacturer's literature as to the effectiveness of the disinfectant and what sort of concentrations. And there is an ISO standard, and I apologise, I can't remember the number of it, but there is an ISO standard that gives guidance on how to calculate the effectiveness of a disinfectant in terms of the number of log order reductions in counts that it can achieve for bacteria and for yeasts and moulds. So it would be good to discuss with the chemical manufacturer if they've had that disinfectant checked against that standard. But I think the key thing to bear in mind is general sort of cleaning and disinfecting. The disinfectant concentration can be, you know, can be different, and it should be different to concentrations that might be used for culture spills. And if you're using a chloride-based disinfectant, just be careful. Some of them can be corrosive to metals, and you don't want to rust your equipment through cleaning.
My second question is related to the same. How do you decontaminate the coat before and after sending to the laundry?
Right. A lot of laboratories, if you don't think the coat has been contaminated, then it's good practice to put all the coats into the microbiology coats into a designated bag, and to ensure that your laundry is aware that they're getting those. They should be washed on a hot boil cycle, not a 30 degree C environmentally friendly temperature. If you think there has been contamination of the coats, then a lot of laboratories will put the coats into an autoclavable bag and autoclave them. But you could also think about chemical disinfection, but then you have a very wet coat in the laboratory. But with good practice, really, coats shouldn't be a contamination risk. If people have been properly trained in good aseptic technique, you shouldn't, generally speaking, have a problem with contamination of coats.
Because my laundry person may not know about which are the microbiological coats and which are the chemical coats. So, but once we receive the coat after washing in the lab, is there any provision to decontaminate in the lab after washing? Can we?
Well, if the coats have been laundered, they shouldn't be contaminated.
One more. What is the condition of the receipt of the sample? Dry samples and fresh samples. Is there in both for frozen condition we should receive the sample? Or dry sample should be received in a dry condition, or frozen sample or fresh sample should be received in a frozen condition?
I think it's important when you're setting up work with your client to discuss the type of samples they're going to be sending you, and to ensure that the transportation conditions maintain the condition of that sample. So if a sample is dry, you wouldn't expect it to come frozen for microbiology. If it's a powder, like milk powder, it would normally be transported under normal conditions. It might be put into a cool box if you've got very high temperature. But if a sample is taken in a frozen state, then ideally the laboratory should receive it in a frozen state. If it's a chilled sample, then ideally the laboratory should receive it in a chilled sample. If your clients want to freeze things before sending it to you, and that freezing is not the normal condition of the sample, then I think it's very important that you make them aware that that perhaps isn't the best practice, and that microbial die-off could occur, and to declare that perhaps the samples were received in a frozen state in the reports. I'm going
Christina
to be around today, so I'm more than happy to take any questions.
And even during the lunch session also, she is available here because of the time shortage. Thank you so much, Christina, for bringing an insight into the microbiological aspect. Now I would request Deputy Director, Pilot Test House, to give a memento to Christina. I think Christina, you may have to drop in.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Very fine. Thank you.